Oh, we're rolling. Okay, Joe DeVito joins us. Finally, you're here.
I know, it's very exciting.
Can I call you the Italian Andy Kindler?
I would love it if you would call me that.
You're the Italian Andy Kindler. You open for Andy, right?
Yeah, a couple of times. Love Andy.
Who doesn't? By the way, have you heard his new podcast?
No.
Thought Spiral?
Oh, God.
With J. Elvis Weinstein? Have you heard this?
No.
Well, download it on iTunes. Andy Kindler and J. Elvis Weinstein. Thought Spiral.
Wow.
It's great. You know what? I said this to J. Elvis. It's like my older brother has a friend over, and he says, you can come into my bedroom, you can listen to us talk, but you can't say anything.
Deal. I'll take that deal.
Right. That's how I describe Thought Spiral. All right. Joe DeVito, this is the first time you've done my show.
It is. It's very exciting.
So, David, I'm going to give him a proper introduction.
Right.
Joe DeVito.
Clubs and colleges, is that what you're going for?
Everywhere.
He plays at clubs on Jersey and the Island. Those are the old intros we used to get.
Joe DeVito has appeared on The Late Late Show a couple times. He's been on Comedy Central's Live at Gotham. He was a semifinalist on season 5 of NBC's Last Comic Standing. Chelsea lately, CNN's Headline News, Animal Planet's Wild 100, a regular on Fox News' Red Eye. You've also had another career.
Before. I did.
You're a journalist. You've written for Maxim, MTV, and you also appeared in the film Super Size Me.
Well, I didn't appear in it. I did some punch-up stuff. I'm friends with Morgan. I tell people that—
Morgan Spurlock,
yeah. I tell people my name is so late in the credits, it's actually the last name you see before the next movie starts. So deep into it.
I like that movie a lot, actually.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it's a great one.
Yeah.
I liked Super High Me. Not Doug Benson.
Oh, that's what I thought it was Doug Benson, yeah.
No, the one about me, just being very Jewish. Super High Me. Super High Me. By the way, Doug was on the show when that first came out, and he said, you're not the only one who's done that.
So, that's the old Jesse Jackson line, right? Hymietown.
Hymietown.
Want to take
I live
you
there.
To Hymietown.
He I'm from Hymietown.
He didn't know.
That's what makes it so racist.
Well, it's not, know. No. It, because first of all, his campaign manager was Jewish, and they were referring to it as Hymietown.
I know, but that's the best. Yeah. It's like when somebody says, oh, I'm going to Jew him down, and they have no idea that that's a completely derogatory term.
I know.
I've had it said to me before, like, no, I just Jewed him down, and I'm like, yeah, I get it. But they have no idea. They have no idea. They're not even being racist. They've just been taught that that's the correct word for bargaining. Hmm.
Joe DeVito.
Yes.
Sorry.
No, I was just going to...
No, you were obviously so angry.
I was going to ask for a response to that.
You're a little anti-Semitic the way you switch gears like that, I have to be honest.
You're Italian.
Yes, that is the correct pronunciation.
You're
yes.
an Italian. I taught my kids that it's... I feel so guilty, but I taught my kids at a restaurant. They'd say, I'll have the Italian dressing, and I would tell my kids it's pronounced Italian.
I'd just like to say... the Italian people are some of the finest people I've ever met. And I would hate for a few bad apples. Thank you.
All right, here we go. We're getting right into it.
It just seemed like it was
so
the
here's
time.
My
Hang
question.
On, so that's JT Spradlin, yes. Who was He's an oil friend. Executive. He was a multimillionaire.
In real life, really?
In real life. And I think he was, I think my theory is he invested in The Godfather. And that's how he got the part.
Huh? Well, he was brilliant.
Excuse
was great.
Me for one second. Okay, so with the hooker, do you remember that scene?
Of course. She was laughing. We'd done it before. I just don't remember. And yeah. I'd just like to say, before I leave these proceedings.
All right, so here's the, excuse me for one second, Mr. DeVito. We're going to interview you. I want you, I don't know how much... we can do this, but you should just be here every taping.
just anytime you say something that sparks, right.
But it's got to be The Godfather.
Of course, that's what I'm saying. That sparks The Godfather, yeah.
All right. I think we're
that's what I do in The Godfather.
Okay.
I'd like to ask the senator a question. I've always been confused. Did he really kill the girl? Because you see, is it Al Neary in the background?
Al Neary, yeah.
So Al Neary killed the girl and they set him up?
Well, I think they drugged him so he would be unconscious. And then, yeah. And then Al Neary, and they set him up, yeah. Well, fortunately, my brother Fredo owns this place, so the girl had no relatives. It's as if she never existed. Yeah. What's left is our friendship.
Yeah. That's what I look for in a woman, and a friendship.
Do you have a woman?
Oh, Ooh, I had just going through a breakup. You know, I don't even want to say going through a breakup because it was pretty definitively broken off a couple weeks ago. But dealing with the aftermath is where I've been the past couple weeks.
Joe's just telling me that he lives, I can say you live in Long Island.
Sure,
or right?
No one's going to come out.
535 Fairlane Lane.
Yes.
Well, but you were just talking about having a relationship outside of Manhattan. Did you guys live together? Or
No. It was unfortunate because we were friends for a long time and decided to give this a whirl. And it was only 5 months, but for me it was a big deal, you know, because I don't really date, you know. And so it's a bummer, you know. But I was thinking about that when I was walking around town here. I thought, I don't know if I could. I see all these beautiful New York women and I think, it's a schlep. Like even my hormones don't make me think.
Where was the girl?
She lives in Astoria, but she was a Long Island girl originally.
But Astoria, the women in Astoria are very sweet.
Yes, you get a little of both.
It's a small town feel,
yeah,
in Astoria.
Because I'm a suburban guy and I would need, I need parking.
Mm-hmm.
It's
totally.
It's very important
that.
To me.
You're like Tony Manero meeting that girl in Manhattan.
Yeah.
And he knew he couldn't keep
David
up
Bowie.
With
him. Yeah, you know who came in the other day? David Bowie. I heard he's half a fag. No, he likes men and boys.
Sorry, I'm every movie I pick now.
Supposedly, if you go back and watch Saturday Night Fever, it's amazing.
It's great.
It's like an independent movie with the Bee Gees.
I watch it once a month, probably. I swear, I love it.
That's a strange movie because every time I watch it, I feel like, okay, I remember this being a comedy before. And then I watch it again, I'm like, this is the saddest, most tragic thing.
Yeah.
And then you watch it again, you're like, this is hilarious.
It's like The Godfather. Not The Godfather, The Sopranos. I didn't know The Sopranos was funny. Until my mother, I watched it with my mother, and she's laughing hysterically. Anyway,
your mother's laughing like those Italian people are hilarious.
They're almost human.
Anyway, so I taught my kids it's Italian. People are Italian, but it's Italian dressing. It has nothing to do with Italy. And I also taught them to call it Chinese Town, not Chinatown. And I think one day I was watching Family Guy, and I think Peter refers to it as Chinese Town as well.
Do they do it as a cutaway?
I don't know.
Remember that time? And it's like, yeah, remember this bit from every show.
So you've been on The Late Late Show, Comedy Central's Live at Gotham, Last Comic Standing.
Yes. I haven't added any new credits since the last time you went through the list.
I'm going through the list. How long have you been doing stand-up?
This month's going to be 16 years. It's crazy.
16 years.
Yeah.
You met this woman, she was your friend. Was she a comedian?
Yes.
That's...
What's her name?
So many bad decisions on my part.
Excuse me for 1 second.
What's her name?
Answer.
Could you repeat the question, Godfather?
What's her name?
I want him here. I want you here all the time.
There's Hollywood Finocchio.
It's Waltz. Waltz. My voice, it's weak. Weak. Sorry.
So, well, don't women, there are some women who want to be friends first, right?
I suppose, yeah. The strangest thing was that I never thought about her romantically until the end of last year. And
what happened?
A couple things. I knew her family moved away and she had nowhere to go for Thanksgiving. And I thought.
So she was desperate.
She was, again, this is the way I like them.
So smart.
No. What I've done in the past is if there's comedian friends of mine who don't have family around, I've invited them to Thanksgiving with my family.
Uh-huh.
And I asked her if she was interested in that. And she had other plans, but I was in session with my therapist. And she said to me, I noticed you keep bringing her name up. And I thought, oh, and then I found a list of things that we'd made of attributes I was looking for in a partner. And she was like 10 out of the 13. So I mentioned to her, hey, would you like to date? And she said, yeah, but she's quite a bit younger than me, too. A lot of bad choices on my part. It's unfortunate.
The Montreal Gazette rated your performance 9.5 out of 10, which you include in your resume, which I love.
Yes.
Well, you don't want to hear more
I
about
do.
How we got out of the friend zone?
I do,
this
but
I need this knowledge.
I know.
I would say she's currently rating my performance significantly lower than the 4.5 out of 10 or whatever it was I got.
So what were the three things? You said she was 10 out of 13.
Yeah.
So what were the three things she didn't have?
She didn't like cats. I've been alone a long time, okay?
And by the way, I find that a virtue. not liking cats. Go ahead.
Some people do.
Cats are murderers.
How dare you?
They murdered my marriage. Go ahead.
Mm-hmm. Usually it's just birds, but a whole marriage.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think the one that in retrospect was a person who had a lot of kindness, and she does not seem to be a particularly empathetic person.
She's a comedian.
Yeah.
So that was, you're looking for kindness?
I know.
That was 11. That was
one of the three. And
I agree
what the
with
other
you about kindness is the most important thing.
Yeah.
Kindness is the most important thing.
Yeah.
That's I know exactly what you're talking about. I broke up with somebody because I was like, she wasn't a nice person.
Yeah, you know, and it's strange because I look back now and I wonder, did this idea I had in my head of this person was it really her? Or was it just something I created in my own mind? Again, pointless mind games I love to play with myself. So.
Mm-hmm. And what was number three?
I don't remember, but the other ones.
Number three was she had a good memory. That was what
that
you
was
were
good in case I misplaced things and wander off.
Hey, so let's review the three things you're looking for that she didn't have.
Yes.
Number one was cats. We've talked about, I'll get to the cats.
She didn't have to have cats, but I do like cats, so that would have been
how
nice.
How many cats do you have?
I don't have any now, but I had
two. I have a cat.
I had two, and then I had one for 20 years, and I swear the moment he died, it dawned on me, like, I should have been having a wife and kids these 20 years. Like, the moment he died, I realized, like, wow, this was a bad call.
Just all right, hang on for 1 second. 20 years.
Yeah.
Fred Stoller was on the show last week.
Love Fred Stoller.
I love Fred Stoller. Pick up his new Kindle single, 5 Minutes to
Just
Kill.
Read it. Just read
it
the other day.
It's amazing.
And very sensitively done, too.
Yeah. Fred has a lot of surprises.
That's about the HBO Young Comics?
Yeah.
Special? Okay. Sorry.
The 1989.
Right.
Young Comedian Special. Okay. So we talked about Mitchell, his cat.
Yeah.
Who died at 20.
Mm.
What was the name of your 20-year-old cat?
His name was Nookie.
See, now I think you're healthier than Fred Stoller because my theory is that people who give human names to cats are out of their mind.
It is.
He's a Nookie. He's not a human being. Yeah.
Well, he came with that name, but I didn't change it.
I changed my cat's name and I named it after.
What's your cat's name?
Selena.
Yeah, see?
Named because it's,
she was killed by her personal assistant.
No, that's what Batgirl, Catwoman's name is, Selina Kyle. So.
Okay.
All right.
The problem with the human names is when the cat dies and then you have a little thing of ashes in your apartment and it says Steven on it, you look like a weirdo. If it says Fluffy, people are like, oh, all right, you know.
I will not be doing that.
Cats are the problem with America.
Okay. Sweeping statement.
Everything that's wrong with this country.
Yeah.
Anything you don't understand, how subhuman we've become, and then we go, how is this possible? It's because of cats. Cats are teaching us it's okay to be narcissistic.
Okay.
That it's okay to change your mind and be spontaneous and be inscrutable. When you say, how is it possible that 1/4 of children in America can go hungry and we're okay with it? It's because of cats. It's because cats have taught us not to care. And because we feed our cats instead of feeding our children. We have health care for cats,
well,
but not for humans. Because let me finish, mister, and then I'll shut up. I'm pointing. I'm angry. Because cats, I've seen this happen to people. I've seen this happen to women. I've been in relationships, and I said, she got a cat. And my shrink said, that's it. You're done.
Mm.
She got a cat. She's done with you. Because cats can replace human contact.
Yes. Well, maybe if those kids would be a little bit more responsive to the laser pointer, we could meet halfway. And B, those women, the crazy cat women, cannot help themselves because of the toxoplasmosis parasite that's found in cat feces. It makes women, it mimics the signs of schizophrenia in women.
What?
And that's why cat crazy, you have the crazy cat lady.
For real?
For
it
real.
Seems
no,
like
I've
you're
done,
being serious.
I've done quite a bit of research into toxoplasmosis.
Okay, let's all calm down here for 1 second.
How dare you say it to me when I'm discussing parasites?
This is the most important thing in the world because my marriage was destroyed by cats because we had at any given time, we had four cats.
Who knew what they were doing?
Who knew what they were doing? Any given time, there were four cats in the house. And then strays. So what is it called?
Toxoplasmosis.
Now, I am convinced that my wife was pregnant just so I had a chance to get.
Of course, yeah. Well, it crosses the blood barrier into the fetus. You got to be careful. Yeah. It's pretty amazing stuff. What this parasite does is it can only reproduce in the stomach of a cat. So what it does is it makes itself and it gets in food that's attractive to rats and mice. And when they eat it, it goes into their brain and messes with the chemistry of their brain, so they're attracted to the smell of cat urine. So the rice,
slow down. You're going way too fast. Start from the beginning.
The parasite can only reproduce in a cat's stomach. So how do you get into a cat's stomach? Well, what it does is it goes somewhere where rats and mice like to eat. Like it gets into grains and stuff like that. The rodents eat it. When it's in their body, it sends something to their brain that changes the part of their brain that usually makes them afraid of cat urine, which is self-preservation, and makes them attracted to it. So these mice and rats go to where this cat urine is, which is where cats are. Cats eat them. The parasite is then released in their stomach and it can reproduce its life cycle.
Okay. What is this thing about the urine? Who's not attracted to urine?
The mice, of course, would avoid cat urine because that's the smell of where cats are. But it changes it so they are attracted to it. So it pretty much sends them on a suicide mission. There's a lot of parasites that do this. They actually, in wasps and moths, where they'll take over the host body and put them in a position where they'll get eaten by something to carry on the parasite's life cycle.
That's cool.
It's invasion of the body snatchers.
It really is. Yeah, it's zombies. Zombies.
So it's a parasite mm-hmm. that changes the thinking of a rodent. Yeah.
And in humans, they believe it makes women schizophrenic and men take unnecessary risks. And I was listening to a lecture about it, and the researcher mentioned to a friend who works in a morgue, and he said, well, you're not going to believe it. A lot of the men we find who die in motorcycle accidents have toxoplasmosis. Wow. They don't know why it makes men do that, but... So it goes to show nature is constantly at war with us. Anybody who says we need to be in harmony with nature is crazy.
Hang on. By the way, I love you. This is great.
This is great.
This is fucking great.
I have a vast breadth of useless knowledge.
No, you don't. No, you don't. Okay, let me review here. Thank you, by the way. Toxoplasmosis. So is it conceivable that I would have this parasite inside of me if I've been changing a cat box?
Yeah.
Does it go away? It can't, right? It's a parasite. It stays forever
until it finds another host. Yeah, until it, for whatever reason, dies.
Now, when you say a parasite
in
me, is he doing my bookings for my club dates? Is he...
No, he's not clearing 10%. That's a different kind of parasite. 20 if it's a college parasite. You usually get a little bit extra. Now, that goes to show you where there's morality, because even toxoplasmosis parasite isn't like, I can get you into a NACA showcase. It's only going to cost you $1,300.
Alex, thank you. Thank you, Alex. I'm in heaven. Okay, this is great. This is making my day. This is so. It's conceivable that because I've had cats for that one is inside of me.
Mm.
Seriously, I mean, could I have a parasite? Would I know?
Well, as far as from what I understand, the human biosphere
is toxoplasmosis. The parasite, or is it some kind of venom that's inside of
me? No. I'm not sure how to say it. Toxoplasmosis, I think, is the condition, but the parasite is a toxoplasmosis parasite. I'm not sure what the correct ending of it is.
Well, would I see it in my stool?
No, it's not like a tapeworm.
It's not? So
look, I'm not going to stop you from looking, okay? That's, you do what you got to do.
I'm from Holly. I hire somebody.
Yeah, I'm just going to say, you might want to hold off on yelling, hey, come take a look at this.
I say, hey, come and take a look at this. That's how sick this relationship I have currently. No, so yeah. If you have cats, it's changing the way you think. Is that what you're
doing? Yeah.
It does make sense. I never liked cats, and I have one, and I am just completely like a different person about cats and her and the way I live. I think I agree. I mean, I think he's right. It makes a lot of sense. I've been a completely changed person once I got that cat.
So they're aliens from, don't you think cats are aliens?
They've definitely figured us out.
Yeah, my cat's pretty smart.
Yeah, they're smart. I mean, and I just love, the awfulness of their attitude, either you enjoy it or you don't, because mm-hmm. a friend of mine who's an EMT told me, he says that there's a lot of times someone will die at home and they'll find them days later with the loyal dog by the side, and they say the cat eats your face yeah. immediately.
Right, really?
Right. Yeah. Oh, I've heard that too.
Without the moment you stop moving, the cat chows down.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Why hasn't this been exposed? Why aren't they...
Norm has a whole bit about this.
Oh, yeah?
On his special. Yeah. On his special, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mark dog Norman is your friend for life, and a cat will eat you. Mm.
The cats eat you when you're dead?
Well, they're not waiting. They're hungry.
Do they across the board?
I don't know if they had a meeting of some
why
type.
Why are they not having congressional hearings?
Well, listen, they're predators. They're, yeah. they're, you know, that's why they're in that family. They just... I don't think they give a crap.
It's just what they do. And I love the attitude that my cat always acted like he was living in a hotel where the service wasn't as good as it used to be. Like, it just, I think that an animal could look at you with disappointment. Like, that's what really, and you really spend your time like, what can I do? And they just, I mean, he rolled his eyes at me once. I thought, come on. It's very hurtful.
Are they capable of love?
Is anyone, is my question these days. I've learned a lot about myself over the past few weeks. But yeah, I mean, I guess what makes it nice with cats is when they are in the mood for affection, it's not like a dog is like, everything's great. You know, a cat comes by on their own terms and you enjoy that. But
and they pet you, they'll get on your chest,
yeah,
right? And they will kind of need...
When they're in the mood.
They'll get on your chest.
And it is very exciting when they're purring. You know, yeah. It's like, oh, the cat likes me today.
It's validating.
It's a great day. Yeah.
I'm getting validated by an animal that poops in a box. Yeah. Just even that alone, the idea of, here's my feces where you live. Scoop them up.
But it is kind of great that they know to pee in that box. And
they know right off the bat.
Yeah, it's amazing right off the bat.
Yeah. That's how I knew he was losing his mind when he got old, where he just was pooping everywhere.
Oh, like, that's when you know.
I didn't take it personally.
Yeah, how do they know? That
I don't know.
They know because they want to bury their turds so other predators don't know that they're around. So it's a way of hiding where they are. It's like the opposite of when they pee to mark places. Mm-hmm. They hide their poop so that it can be stealthy.
So when I
it's
often...
A good animal.
Smart. Is the cat kneading my chest... Or is it trying to bury me because it thinks I'm a turd?
I can't get into specifics. I can't say what you and your cat's relationship uh-huh. would be. Well, they say they do that. It's mimicking stimulating the mammary gland in the mother before nursing. So that's why they do that kneading motion.
That's why? Because what?
It's when they were a kitten, they would do that before nursing to stimulate the milk production in the mother's mammary gland. So it was a way to get the milk flowing.
Did you ever see that cartoon with that giant dog, one of the Warner Brothers cartoons, like Bugs Bunny one with the giant dog and the cat, the little cat that used to do that on the dogs, and he used to go crazy. He's like because he was, you know, hurting because the cat was kneading, but then he was like found it so adorable.
Mm-hmm. I don't remember that.
Remember
one.
That one?
Is that the one who kept asking for gravy?
No.
Do you remember that one? This time I didn't forget the gravy.
No, that's not the one.
Hang on for one second. You know, I saw something like that in the newspaper. My son at 3 was reading the funny papers.
The funny papers. I said, all right, I want to go back to that cat business again. maybe I'll go back to the...
It's okay. It's okay, Pop. It's okay.
I don't know. I didn't want this for you. Interviewing comedians the rest of your life. And then Senator Feldman. President Feldman.
Some other Pesnavante.
Pesnavante in the church.
I always wondered how many boxes they have James Caan standing on to look physically imposing. Everyone in that tiny movie was like 5'2". Mm-hmm.
All the
Excuse
famous
me, I
actors.
I have a question. Can I be careless?
Well, women and children can be careless, but not men. I refused.
What?
I refused to be a puppet. I thought it would be you pulling the strings. I refused to look foolish.
I have an idea. Next week, you just come in and just sit there. And I just say...
I'll do it every time.
Just throw to different characters.
I just think Corleone. I think it'd just be funny. Just
as a correspondent.
I like podcasts. I like talking into a microphone. I don't know.
What about...
I drink a lot more wine than I used to.
What if I do a podcast about white powder?
Listen. So they can't resist. I don't want it sold in schools. I don't want it sold to children.
Let them have their own community, the colors, the darkies. They're animals anyway. Let them lose their souls.
And then, did you see what I had in this one? I had the guy from Caddyshack come in, William Stevenson, and he couldn't pronounce Judge Smales. Never saw Caddyshack. He goes, colored boy, why are you little? And then he goes, hey, Vito, what do you say? The Smales. He couldn't. He goes, the Smith. It's Smales, you idiot. Like, the one comedian I've ever met that's never seen Caddyshack. Smith, what is it? He had no idea what we were doing. I thought he'd be happy that we're calling attention to the fact that I say colored boy. I think he thought it was worse. Colored boy, why are you little? Sorry.
So, Joe DeVito, how many cats have you
Let's
had?
Let's run through those credits one more time.
How many cats?
Maxim have you, magazine.
I how many them. Cats have you had in your lifetime? Can you name them all?
Yeah. Well, the two that I had were Nookie and Belle. Nookie lasted 20 years. Belle died of an oral cancer. All that smoking.
Belle died. You know, if Belle sounds like somebody who would smoke a lot.
She did. That hoarse voice. And those were the two I had. And then my parents had patches for 18 years. My parents had a cat for 18 years and a cat for 15 years. And they have the little grave markers out and back. And it's very creepy because they live so long. It's like some Civil War tombstones.
Because you grew up with cats.
Yeah.
Where'd you grow up?
We didn't have any pets.
I grew up in a town in Connecticut. We moved there from the Bronx when I was a kid. It's a town called New Milford up by Danbury.
Okay.
And I moved to Long Island about almost 20 years ago.
And were they outdoor cats or indoor cats?
Indoor cats.
Spoiler. Don't you think, I have a new theory about cats. I think you put a bell on them.
Mm.
You put a bell on Belle. And you let them go outside and murder.
That's what they do.
But if they have a bell, it's a fair fight.
I feel like they work around it. Maybe they go after deaf birds or something. They do a little reconnaissance.
Because the choice is, if they're indoors, they're going to murder your furniture.
Yeah.
So what? What's so great about your furniture?
You can't declaw them.
So?
So they...
Who cares? What's so great about furniture?
You can't...
What are you, my mother?
This is how they have us...
What does a man think about that? What's the matter with you? How are you going to act like a man?
I actually opened for Al Martino.
No
for
way.
For Johnny Fontaine.
Really?
Yeah. It was. I would imagine it was moments before he passed away. He was so old.
Oh, he's dead?
Yeah, yeah.
My voice, it's weak. It's weak. I don't know. Act like a man. Did you ever see the SCTV version?
Yes. That was a long sketch.
Yeah, you can start by giving me some of that cheese. No, I can't do it. I can't.
Johnny Pavarotti.
Yeah, Johnny Pavarotti. He's going for the lasagna. That's John Candy.
Yeah.
I was on a show the other day and we did some like OTB type horse racing type stuff. And I found
Does OTB even exist?
No. There's like two of them left.
No, I don't think. Yeah. Are you sure?
There's one in Levittown, Long Island.
Oh,
in Long Island.
Tell everybody what OTB is.
It's off-track betting, and it's to give you an example, there used to be one in Midtown, and there was a restaurant attached to it called the Winner's Circle, which always made me laugh.
Oh, that's right by my house. It's on 2nd Avenue and 52nd, right?
Yeah, I think so. Because let me tell you, you go to an OTB, you won't find enough winners to make a triangle or a circle. It is the most depressing place.
Yes, it was. I would be going there today because today's the Preakness. Normally, if it was still open, I would have gone today.
Yeah. But we were doing that.
What killed OTB?
Well, because it was run by the government, and it just goes to show even the government couldn't make gambling work, how inept the government is. But we were doing that, and I found that old Jack Walls, is that the name of the movie producer?
Yeah.
And I found, as a joke, I sent that to my friends, but I realized, like so many Godfather characters, I would watch a whole movie about
him. Did you feel
ridiculous
sending it to them?
Because a man in my position can't be made to look ridiculous. Oh, you'll get out of here.
I like the TV edit where he says, "She was the best piece of stuff I ever had."
I like, in Caddyshack, they change Rodney's line, too, where they're like, "Hey, everybody, we're all going to take a shower," instead of getting laid.
I love when they get so abstract. Well, of course, to me, the famous one is the diehard Mr. Falcon. Instead of mother, they say Mr. Falcon. It's like, okay, you're introducing a new character.
Wait,
now.
And what?
One of the diehards.
Oh, and diehard. Yeah. I'm sorry. You said that. I thought you.
Yeah.
So you worked as a journalist for 10 years?
It was mostly advertising stuff. I did the journalism on the side. I worked for Book of the Month Club.
But you wrote for Maxim. I wrote for Maxim too.
I wrote a couple articles.
Did you work with that guy? Who was the head that one was dating Rose McGowan? Is that her name? What's the hot girl that used to date Marilyn Manson?
Yeah, guy? I believe that's her. Yeah.
What was it? David something.
I don't know, because I obviously was a freelancer, so I was pretty...
Me too.
I worked with the editor.
Oh, you worked at Maxim?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I wrote an art of my best one was How to Pick Up Girls at the Holocaust Museum.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I am serious.
Excuse me for one second.
Yeah, I had to go down there and...
You went down
there? It was a travel piece about D.C. and to meet au pairs and How to Pick Up Girls at the Holocaust Museum.
But you must have gotten complaints, right?
No, got no complaints, because I think I did it the right way where I kind of made myself look foolish, so it wasn't that bad. But I will – there. You can
That's
pick
offensive.
Up a girl.
That's
you can
offensive.
Pick up a girl at that museum. I had this theory that only women can go – men can't handle it. Mm. And women are better at handling this kind of horribleness.
Because they create
they're
it.
Smarter. I don't know. They're just better at compartmentalizing, I think.
Well, I buy that. Stupid,
but you know what they do? They go, oh, look at those shoes. Look at all those shoes.
Well, I was trying to put it in a good way where I think like if you have two couples going to D.C., the women will say, well, we should probably go to the Holocaust Museum. The men will go to the Air and Space Museum. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of, and my theory was correct.
Well,
there was a lot of women.
Two fallacies. We can learn about the moon landing or the Holocaust, both of which
right.
were invented.
Yes.
They're all hoaxes. Yeah. But no, I what I found was there were a lot of women in there. A lot of women, a lot of single girls going in just, I mean, because they don't seem to mind. And I was, and they have couches. It's candlelit in there. I mean, if you are a horrible human being, yeah. you can absolutely pick up a girl in there.
This sounds to me like the Fonz teaching Richie Cunningham to hit women in the supermarket with the cart.
Oh my God, that's my favorite one. Yeah. And he hits Richie with, oh no, he hits the Fonz. Richie tries it and he ends up hitting the Fonz with the cart. That is one of the funniest, it still makes me laugh.
I want to rein this in for one second because,
sorry.
I do a lot of Holocaust jokes mm-hmm. on this show, and I'm trying to cut back because I kind of...
Give yourself a budget. Certain
I've exceeded them. I have. So there were no complaints?
No, nobody complained.
And did you pick up a woman?
I was stalking, I guess this is the only polite way to say it. Like, this one girl who was very attractive, and I was going to... And I think in the article, I think I said, because it was about 10 years ago, that I couldn't do it. Couldn't bring myself to be that
you
guy.
Couldn't close it.
Yeah. Mm. I would too. You can't. If you're a human being, especially a Jew, it's just too, you know, that's not right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But it would be easy if, I don't know, maybe if I had game of some sort or
yeah.
just was a horrible human being.
Holocaust games, very high level.
You're
a real pickup artist for that.
You know what? I'm going to tell you, I'm ashamed to tell you this. There was a game we used to play in the house called Sophie's Choice. I'm being serious. Because we had four cats, always four cats, and at least three dogs. And my kids would have friends over, and I'd walk into a room, and they'd be playing with the animals. I go, Sophie's Choice! And they go, Cody. They would have to pick...
The low... If you're talking about the pets or the friend who had
pet.
To go?
Oh, they okay. had to pick a pet... that I was gonna.
Wow, that's one way to prepare them to deal with loss.
Is that,
some test runs?
Is that wrong? That I that's the truth.
It's wrong, but it's also brilliant, and it is only cats. We have to keep remembering, even though I worship my cat and everything. They are only cats. I have to keep putting that in my head.
My kids were watching South Park and Family Guy.
Uh-huh.
And I told somebody, well, what are the bad things you used to do? We used to play Sophie's Choice with the animals.
It's really funny.
Is that horrible?
No, that's funny.
Okay. Another thing we used to do with the cat, we had a crazy Sammy, and he was black and white, and I'd play fetch with him. I'd literally curl him up into a ball, and he would start purring.
Yeah.
Aww.
And then I'd slide him down the hallway, and he'd slide, and then he'd turn around.
And come back
to have it done again.
Yeah, I liked it.
You had a good thing going then.
Somebody said, how could you do that to the cat? I said, if he didn't like it, why do you keep coming back?
Right, right. I know. I feel sometimes when I hear those articles and stuff of the way that people abuse animals and stuff, I think about it all. It makes me upset.
Men treat cats differently than women do. This is what I've noticed. And then we'll change the subject. Men do not pet cats. Men do deep tissue massage.
We roughhouse.
Oh, that's true.
I've never seen a woman. I'd be interested to see what Caitlin does with a cat. I wonder if that changes with the transitioning. Because when a man sees a cat.
You're talking about Caitlin Jenner.
Caitlin Jenner, yeah. When a man sees a cat, your first instinct is deep tissue massage. If the cat scratches and bites, we will leave the apartment covered in
it's
blood.
Game on.
It's game on, right? And women go, what are you doing? What are you doing? I had baseball mitts. Somebody said, you play softball? No, I play with my cat.
I used to like to pet the head but hold the ears back so the eyes bulged out a little bit. And then usually do like a little movie dialogue. That would be kind of fun. I also used to do something, and I told a friend of mine who had a cat too, and I called it kitty bagpipe. And he said, I don't even know what that is, but that sounds like something my wife would yell at me for doing a cat. Right. And what I would do is I would hold the cat and I would pet him, and when he purred at the right moment, I would squeeze him. So he would go, and then you pretty much do that until they attack you for your transgressions. And rightfully so. I'd be like, I earned that one.
Frank Conniff has a book out about the trial between him and his cats. But he was serious. He came in one morning to do the show. And he had a Band-Aid on. And I said, what happened? He said, Barney scratched me. He was just sitting next to me. Barney's his cat. And he said, he scratched me. And I said, what'd you do? He said, fuck you, Barney. Just this is why I think cats are ruining America, because we are in a fake relationship with a living thing. It's not real. And they replace human beings.
You're so right. I think that's why I haven't been in a relationship since I've had a cat. I swear. Yeah. I mean, it's like
they give you just enough humanity to satiate you. You get, it feels good when they're next to you watching TV. They're warm. It's a combination. For a guy, it's the combination of a blanket and a woman who...
It's weird. You know, I've been trying to think of why I'm okay with like staying home on the weekends now, whereas you used to get really depressed, years ago. And I thought maybe it had something to do with the fact that there's so much to watch on TV and the internet and cell phones, and you're so connected that I thought maybe that was the reason. But that all happened once I had a cat. So I can't decide which is the reason why I'm not upset about not going out anymore. I'm missing something.
If you want to trace the decline of this country...
He's obsessed.
Chart the increase of cat ownership. Mm-hmm. We own them. Cat ownership rises in direct relation to the popularity of tax cuts for the richest 1%. That's my theory.
I think you've lost your mind.
I haven't.
I think there's also the appeal that the cat, you mentioned it gives you just enough of the emotional thing, but it also lets you do enough caretaking to appeal to that part of yourself.
Exactly.
That you're feeding something and keeping it warm and taking care of it.
When you should be taking care of the 25% of American children.
Well, when you mention that, I didn't think about that.
It gives you exactly right.
Why am I pampering this cat when there's a whole bunch of, you're right. That's a good point.
It's the same way that people think forwarding an online petition means they've actually done something. It doesn't actually do anything in the real world, but it still releases those endorphins and gives them that sense of superiority that they've made a contribution in a way when all they've done is press a button.
Yeah.
They haven't done anything.
Right. And I'm a vegan, borderline vegan.
Oh, you are? That's why you mentioned
borderline personality, borderline.
Which side of the borderline are you on?
I'll have dairy occasionally and cheese.
I don't understand vegan. How could you become?
Because I don't want death inside of me. I already am dead enough inside as it is.
I think that was my ex's main
complaint.
You believe
in that stuff. That's ridiculous. Well,
it's ridiculous?
Yeah.
What do you mean it's ridiculous?
I understand being a vegetarian,
You can't say ridiculous without saying it like Jack
Waltz.
I thought
we had already done it. That's why I was...
Do it again.
Because a man in my position can't be made to look ridiculous. Now you get out of here, and you tell the Godfather, I ain't no band leader. Yeah. I hide that story. How's your... Wait, what's SCTV like? How's your Salisbury steak, Tom? Just double portions. Do you like singing zucchinis?
No, I'm a vegetarian slash vegan. I love animals, but they're not humans. Mm-hmm. And before we start taking care of all these animals, which we have to, mm-hmm. You judge a society by how it takes care of the weakest among us.
Yeah.
The weakest among us are human beings. We have humans to take care of first. Don't hurt an animal. You should have a cat. You should have a dog. But what you're getting from that cat or dog, well, dogs I like. But
no, I know exactly what you're talking about. And you're completely right. Because when they have those commercials of the ASPCA on mm-hmm. those really sad ones, mm-hmm. I have to turn them off.
Yeah.
Right. But if they have the starving children, I'm like, what are you going to do? Hey, it's what happens.
That's a rough one to watch when you just sat down with a sandwich.
Right, right. No, it is tough, but I can keep it on. It doesn't mm-hmm. bother me as much as the animals. What's the matter with me?
Well, what does that say about us?
Well,
it says we're idiots.
I feel like emotionally you have to draw a line somewhere, or you just, because of life is suffering for the most part, and we're so lucky that we don't have to deal with it. I think, you know, a friend of mine told me, he said, you know you're a real New Yorker the moment you step over a person lying in the street and without breaking your conversation you're having with somebody. And I've seen that in people visiting New York who just be like, my God, you just stepped over another human being. And you'd be like, oh, yeah, but, you know, it's not really like that. It's like, well, it kind of is exactly like that.
Yeah, yeah. You know, you're right. With the car crash that happened in Times Square, the mm-hmm. guy murdering those people. If you look at the
video. Did he do it on purpose?
Yes.
He will. Yes, I believe he wanted the cop to shoot him. So.
Yeah, but he also was on a half PCP, something like. But he did do it on purpose. He was trying to.
But he's not with ISIS, so it's okay that those people died. Yeah. So it's good. It's fine.
Well, that's the way we have to look at it, right? But I saw people just kind of walking by, like right. Well, there's a picture of him. Some guy got lucky, and there's a picture of him going crazy in the thing. But you just see another guy, and the car had just, you know, barreled in people. Then you just see people just walking by in the photo. Mm.
Yeah.
It's just like
you got places to be.
Yeah. It's like, this happens in Times Square all the time.
I have this theory that Trump has brought New York City, Manhattan specifically, mm-hmm. to America. The idea that you can walk over a homeless person in Manhattan and not think twice, which is true. You cannot survive in Manhattan with empathy.
Yeah. You'll get wrung out two blocks.
You do triage.
I've been doing that since I was 12.
You do
triage. My dad told me, you just step over him.
Yeah. It's emotional triage. You have to say, no, I can't feed everybody. There's always going to be homeless people. There's always going to be the poor. That is a Manhattan mindset that Trump has brought to the country. What he's also brought to this country is, and it's true, there are no laws in Manhattan.
Not for white people.
The idea of a guy who pours cement in Manhattan. Donald Trump poured cement in Manhattan, and he built casinos in Atlantic City and Las Vegas, but it was financed by Wall Street. If you are surrounded by people who pour cement and Wall Street, there are no laws.
Yeah, because of all the corner cutting and deal making that needed just to get to that point.
Just make it. Make it. We'll worry about it later. Say anything. Yeah. Just get this building built. They'll bring in the inspectors and we'll pay them off. And if we can't pay them off, we'll pay the fines. Just if you get the bill, they're not going to knock the building down. They're not going to knock it down. So just make the building.
But in some ways,
that's his thinking.
Some ways, I think. That's one of the things I like about New York is that there's a sense of, even just when it comes to crossing the street in New York, there's a sense of forget about what the lights are telling us. It's like, you think you can make it? Go for it. You think you can get to that other side? Give it a shot.
That's right.
And that's why I've noticed when I drive through Manhattan that the people who cause trouble are not the ones driving like lunatics. As long as you're all driving like lunatics, it has a flow to it. It's the one person trying to be a decent human being that screws everything up.
At some point.
It's like, yeah, because they're
you're
not.
So right.
It's not. You're, as long as you're all constantly trying to cut each other off, there's sort of a flow to it.
When you're driving through and people are walking through red lights when you're driving, do you stop? Because I just keep going and I don't even beep.
Yeah.
And I go like, no, they're going to move. But if somebody were to stop, it's going to cause trouble.
Yeah, I feel like
when you have the right of way.
Well, I don't run the person over, but I do feel like I need to teach them a lesson.
That's what I'm talking about.
But on the other side, I've also been a pedestrian who legitimately thought I could make a car stop by giving it a dirty look. Mm-hmm. That's how insane you get.
Yeah.
I almost got hit by a car 2 days ago. And I was crossing the street, and I had easily five ticks left on the thing. And this car took a right turn, and it went so close to me that I was aware of, like, oh, that almost touched my face. But I wasn't even – it didn't even bother me. And then I cross the street, and I see two homeless people staring at me, slack-jawed. And they're like, that car almost hit you. And I was like, yeah. And I really think said, what are you going to do?
See, I think I don't want to get into New York versus the rest of the world, but I do believe that this is a Manhattan phenomenon.
Sure.
And it through the prism of Trump. In Manhattan, you can say anything to anybody and not get punched. When I moved to San Francisco, I once gave a trucker the finger. Somebody cut me off. Mm. I gave the guy the finger, and the guy followed. He was going to kill me.
Yeah.
I go, what's the big deal? I gave you the effing finger. Yeah. But in New York, and I think that's what Trump thinks, is you can say, I saw a 70-year-old white woman, I think she was Italian, in a muumuu, screaming at a 6'8" black guy who was not cleaning up after his poodle. He had a little teacup.
Yeah.
And she's screaming, I'll kill you. I'll kill you. And he's going, ah, like that.
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, you can say with impunity, this woman in the muumuu and slippers on the streets of Manhattan is looking up at the 6'8" guy going, I'm going to kill you if you don't clean up after this effing. And he's going, blow it out your ass. Like, there's no violence. It's just.
Well, it's also that instant emotional acceleration where it goes straight to the top. There's no back and forth of a buildup. But there's so many different.
And I didn't mean it, and people forget about it.
Yeah.
In Manhattan.
Yeah. Yeah.
But that doesn't apply anywhere else.
No, it's considered a legitimate threat. I was hanging out with a friend of mine who's Brooklyn born and bred, and we were getting ready to have dinner with her and her fiance, and her kid was running around the kitchen. And it made me laugh because she just went, Michael, stop it or I'm going to strangle you. And to me, that was so Italian, the idea of like a specific way you're going to kill your child. And he didn't even care. It had no impact on him. I'm like, you just said you're going to strangle your child.
This is what I don't think people understand about Trump, who has to be removed and he's a danger. He goes in to meet with Kislyev and the Russian foreign minister. He's making small, I just got rid of this Comey guy. He's a nut job. He wasn't saying, now I'm free to do your services, my overlords, my payment. He was just making New York small talk.
Yeah.
I just got rid of this cop. He's out of his, he's a nut job. Can you believe it? How you guys do it? That's right. That's just, yeah, just New York City small talk.
Well, I think that's why the Russians have been so confused by us, because the Russians never do anything without thinking three-level chess.
Right.
So they're the masters of strategy manipulation. And I think they've looked at U.S. foreign policy over the past 20 years or so, and they're thinking, what could this grand plan possibly be? Because we've just been sort of flailing. Mm-hmm. But
that's a good point.
Yeah, I think you're right about the New York differences. Like, I've noticed, and I also think, like, I know we were talking about Andy Kindler earlier. He doesn't like any jokes about the homeless. Fair enough. But what
Me neither.
But I've learned in other parts of the country, when you say homeless, it means something very different. Outside of New York, when you're in New York and you say a homeless man, people think crazy guy,
a guy
yelling stuff and threatening you and being an aggressive panhandler. That's what you think homeless means. The rest of the country, they think, oh, that poor person lost their home. So they think of someone who had a home, there was an event, and now that person is no longer living indoors.
Well, that's really interesting.
It's a completely different view of what that word means. So when you say a homeless guy was bothering me or something, people from outside New York think they have empathy for that person, whereas we have trouble seeing that person as anything other than an emblem, an engram of what that word means.
It used to be bum. Remember?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. A tramp.
Journalism.
Yes.
Tell me about your journalism career.
Well, I wrote a story for Maxim about testicle implants for pets.
Nudicles.
Yeah. Nudicles, yes.
That's true?
Yeah. They make, because for a while you couldn't get them for men, and people were buying the animal ones to get put in. And the guy, of course, was complete Looney Tunes that I interviewed. But he said he made them for cats, dogs, horses, and bulls. And he said, the dogs know that when the animal has an empty sack at the dog run, like, he has confidence issues.
Oh,
So this is what he said. So I said, all right, my cat's fixed. What if I got those bull balls and put them in? Would, he, would that give him a lift? And the guy got mad at me and he was like, yeah, you know, what's the idea of like, you're not taking these silicone pet implants seriously.
Where do you get the, where do you get the nudicles to talk to a man like me in that tone of voice?
So I did that, but for most...
Let's go back to nudicles.
Okay.
Do they lick their nudicles?
It's inside to them. I believe they're slogan.
Do they have a taste? They taste like, because I...
No, they're on the inside.
Yeah, but you lick your balls.
I don't know if they're really, it's not like you can get flavors of them. It was more
what
my
are you
size.
Talking about? Haven't then you ever licked a pair of balls? I can tell a pair of nudicles.
I know the scent of my balls, but...
I do too.
But that's. I think that's all scrotum.
This podcast has taken a very odd turn.
Yeah. Well, all right.
Okay, so you wrote about the nudicles. I thought it was a cosmetic thing. I thought it was a lot of Beverly Hills types and Manhattan types who were ashamed that their dog didn't have testicles.
Yeah.
Is that what it was about?
I think so, because
well,
I don't...
You said there was a... Oh, you said that guy said there
the
was
guy
a confidence
said that.
Issue. But
yeah,
it makes
I don't
sense
if,
to me if you're
know,
with other dogs.
But I know so many people whose dogs have lost a leg, and once they come out of the anesthesia, they kind of they don't worry about it.
That's true.
I don't know.
Then, so what was your article about?
My article was just about an interview with the guy and...
Dogs don't have confidence issues. They're either alphas or betas.
I guess.
And it's ingrained. Or do they change? Can a dog suddenly become an alpha?
Yeah, I think it depends on who and where you are in
we're
the
in
pack.
We're in the pack, yeah. Cody became an alpha. Cody was a beta. Mm. And then he eventually became... an alpha.
And then that's what happens to alpha animals when they get replaced. They usually just have to go off somewhere and die.
Oh.
Because they're kind of done.
Once you're an alpha, you can't go back to being a beta.
No, because then the guys who replace you know that you're nothing but a threat, so they kick your ass out.
Suppose they sense that you're just getting old.
Not a lot of compassion in the animal world. I don't think there's like a pension program for old lions.
What about if they just give you a corner office? You come in, just...
You punch a clock, you write it out, you move to Florida.
It is really like corporate America, isn't it?
It's exactly like, well, I think it's corporate America really is like that.
Like the animal kingdom.
Yeah. We're animals.
We're animals anyway. Let them lose their souls.
What
boy.
Did you do before Maxim in terms of journalism? Did you want to be a reporter for... like?
Not really, because, well, my thing in college was I wrote for the school newspaper, so that's where... That was my main... benefit of going to college was that I learned to write well and do it on deadline and all that kind of stuff. I finished college in 90s. There was a recession going on, so there really wasn't much happening. And I lived in small town Connecticut. And I was very immature, so I used that as an opportunity to grow my hair out and play in rock bands and stuff and sell pot and work in a video store and stuff like that. And I regret none of that, by the way.
Would you have worked at a newspaper if you could have?
You know, I tried, and the local newspapers weren't interested. But you look back, a local newspaper has 5 employees who've been there for 100 years. They don't want someone who's come in winning journalism awards and stuff like that. They don't want you around.
I got lucky in the sense that I'm not a very good writer. Like, I don't know the, you know, I'm not smart in the... in
articulate.
Yeah.
I think that's the word happening. You were searching for.
Yeah. I think senile is the word.
Yeah, I guess so. So I got lucky that the magazines kind of changed... when I got out of school, I got out of school 4 years earlier, and that I would never have been able to write for a magazine like a U.S. World and News Report or the Times or something like that. But then publications like Maxim kind of dumbed it down.
I was able to
write like I talk, and that made all the difference. Mm. I would never have been able to write because I don't know whether I told you this, but one time this girl had me write for Backstage West magazine because she knew I wrote for Maxim, and she wanted me to interview this guy who I'd seen in this Broadway show, and said nobody in LA knows about Broadway. I was the perfect guy to do it. So it was just a Q&A, but the first 3 paragraphs were supposed to be written like a journalist. Mm. She must have sent it back to me 4 or 5 times. And she's like, I don't understand how you got a job at Maxim, because I didn't have...
Yeah, that news sort of...
Who, what, where, when, why, how in the first paragraph.
Yeah, and it was very obvious.
That all helped me a lot when I went into advertising writing, and I know advertising writing helped me with comedy, because way before Twitter, I would have someone say, you only have a certain number of letters in this headline to compel somebody to do something. Mm-hmm. And I worked on a little ad agency. We had boring products, industrial stuff, writing brochures for like the thing that went into the machine that made the plastic for a pen. And that helped me because you learn word economy and things like that. That's the one thing that drives me nuts about new comics is just listen to them blathering on, and it's like no one stops them. No one takes them aside and tells them, no, you're not a storyteller. You're a bullshitter.
Go on. No, I'm serious. Go on.
Yeah, it just drives me nuts because it's so self-indulgent. And I don't know if it still goes on, but I remember a couple years ago there was a big phase where everyone was like, come see my one-person show. And you're like, oh, that's God, right. It's just, you mean I'm going to watch you for an hour with not even trying punchlines?
Right.
Ain't going to happen.
Yeah, plus a lot of the newcomers, like you said, they're, you know, they see Louis and they're like, yeah, I just do all new material every month. I throw it out because that's what Louis does. And they're not Louis at all.
I agree with their throwing that material out part, but I'd rather they did it before we had to hear it.
It's bad in that sense.
Okay, I find this interesting because I run with the 20-somethings. Mm. I've noticed something, and I think it's I always filtered through politics and the anxieties of influence, as they call it. I don't think you can look at what's going on without understanding the anxieties of influence. That's not my term. It's an old term. But we do things because of the air we're breathing. I think during the Obama administration, we had a very generous, forgiving country. And these comics who I was running with, they were doing open mics, trying new material. Mm. And I said, that bit worked. Why aren't you doing that again? It's old. Kind of like what you're just saying.
Yeah.
I said, don't you want to build an act? No, I don't need an act. I just want to keep build an act.
And yeah, it's not like that anymore. I don't think it's... I remember it used to take... When we first started, when all of us first started, like it used to take 7 years to be good. And now you can be good in like 6 months or whatever you consider good to go to the next level. It's completely different, let alone the...
But it's better.
The little...
It is better.
The girls, the really pretty girls that think they're comics now that are younger, they're so interesting because they know how to work social media. So it makes it look like they are complete... I'm like, well, that girl's doing really well. They're like, no, she's not doing well. It just looks like she's doing well on social media. She knows how to work it. And then they come out, you know, they're not good comics. Of course, they get work because they're pretty, but they know how to work the social media. So they'll be like, yeah, I'm, you know, working with, instead of saying opening or whatever, they know how to work it just the right way.
Here's the danger you're running into. You're like the second chair violinist at the New York Philharmonic who doesn't understand Bob Dylan. Because the young comics are doing something completely different than what you're doing.
Yeah.
It's a
we
whole,
don't understand.
We don't. It's very personal, and they're saving comedy because it's so personal. Because we're doing John Philip Sousa marching music. They're doing folk songs. It's very personal.
Yeah.
It's very, and that's what people are hungering for. That's why an unfunny person can be a comedian. They'll come out and see you even though you don't know comedic theory, the same way Bob Dylan didn't know musical theory. But it's so personal, and it's all about the audience falling in love with the person.
Like none of them like drink anymore. They don't hang out. You know, it is really a different.
Don't get me wrong. I hate them, but only because of their youth.
Yeah,
no,
their knees don't hurt. Yeah, it is a strange thing because I started this in 2001. So I was 32 years old, so I was kind of old to be starting this.
Yeah.
And I look back to when my group used to do the open mics and stuff like that. We all sort of thought, well, we just want to go up and have our jokes work. And now when I stop at the open mics, I hear the young comics talking about industry and Montreal. And it's like, well, you don't have two jokes yet. So to me, that seems odd, but I understand
what
you're
saying. It's the music. The analog is the music industry.
Yeah, it's Nirvana cracking everything open.
And for you and
then and
me,
then they, file sharing and all that stuff.
No, what I'm saying is when we start. Well,
when we started, they didn't even have an open mics.
Right.
You just had to try and get out of the clubs.
They didn't have the word open.
Yes. Well, no, you had
everything
to.
Everything was closed. You had to close a door to get in. You had to close a door to.
We didn't start
to get
with
out.
Open
they
mics.
Didn't have a word called open back when I was.
But they didn't. We just had to go to the clubs and wait around.
It was horrible.
Yeah.
And that doesn't mean it was good because
I didn't say that.
Yeah.
No, it was horrible.
Yeah. You don't.
I wish there were open mics.
You don't want to romanticize deprivation because to compare it to music, I think of there's a band I love called Sonic's Rendezvous Band. It was a guy from the MC5, and they were an amazing band, but because no one signed them, all we have officially released by them is one single.
Who played Kick Out the Jams?
That's the MC5.
Okay. Yeah. Jerry Stahl turned me on to them.
Oh, great stuff. So now it's like, it's the price you pay. A great band now has within their own hands to distribute their music. And that's great. The problem is it means you're saturated with a lot of not great bands who are able to do the same thing. And I think that's...
Can I...
Just media is like that.
Maybe I sound like an old guy, but in my day, my father used to come home drunk. He would beat my mother and say to the kids, see what you make me do. And then we'd cower in the corner hoping he wasn't going to beat me. And then we'd go to sleep and we'd wake up in the middle of the night to the sound of my father beating my mother and drinking and smashing things. And that's what made me funny and strong and good.
That's a horrible story.
No, what I'm saying is...
And that's how you end up with iTunes. That's the end result of that.
I mean, again, it's romanticizing horror because we're resilient. We always have to say we have to be forgiving of our past. I can't read. Are we wrapping it up? Yeah, we are. Oh, the minute I start talking about beating... Joe, you'll come back?
I would love to. This is a lot of fun.
Yeah, talking about, you know, old comedy like this, it's kind of fun. It's kind of the best.
Well, I worry about being hostile towards young people. Here's what I do think.
I do, too. I know what you're talking about.
Right. Hmm. The thing about millennials, though, I will say this about them. Now that Trump is president, I think comedy is going to change. The millennials who started doing comedy under Obama, you know, the cliche, they all got a trophy.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody gets a trophy. Everybody, I did something. Mommy, I made a duty. Look at it. Oh, that's beautiful, son. Here's a trophy. I think those days are over, and I think it's going to show up in comedy. I think the audiences are going to change because audiences always do change, and they're going to demand something else.
Hopefully older folks.
Well, that's never going to be the case.
I know.
That's never going to be the case. But.
They don't want people talking about the $6 million man and how great that show was. The hell's the matter with these people?
What's so impressive about a man costing $6 million?
I know. It's like, that's your regular health care cost. what did you get your spleen removed? Congratulations.
You're not following. He was $6 million. He had an eye.
All right. Let's plug some gigs. I believe, David, you have a podcast.
No, I have a podcast, the Dave Juskow podcast.
The David Juskow podcast.
I'm also doing a benefit show on June 14th. I put together this benefit show for the Big Brothers Big Sisters organization at Gotham Comedy Club. I had to do it first to get out to some community service to get out of some trouble. But
is
now,
that true?
Yes, it is true.
Well, hang on. What'd you do?
I
molested a little boy.
He was impersonating a big sister.
I've asked to be a big sister, but they will not let me do that. No, I changed my license plate to reflect a different number to park on the street. Didn't work out the way I expected. Make the long story short.
You changed your license?
Yes.
I
put some Play-Doh on it and I made a nine and eight.
And the cop caught you?
Not for a year. No, the cop didn't come. The guy I had that number caught me. It never occurred to me somebody in Jersey had that number. That's like that's how thieves get caught. That never occurred to me that somebody had that plate number that I made up.
So they made you do community service?
I had to do community service. I had to go to jail for a little bit, but I had to
do
community.
You went to jail?
Just for like a couple of days.
Did you? Wow.
The tombs, you know.
Really?
Yeah, but I figured out when I was there, I seem to go to jail every 15 years or so.
Wow. You're like a criminal cicada.
You have to come back.
I heard you also had hand in your Honk If You Love Jesus bumper sticker.
You have to come back and talk about blowing all those guys. How quickly do you have to start blowing guys?
No, you don't, because I was like, after a while, I was like the senior tenant. So they were all coming to me, you know, being older. They were like, they figured I was a white crime guy and I could probably help them get out. I was like the Bernie Madoff of the cell.
How many days in jail?
Just two, this time. But there was a problem, you know, when I went to court, I thought I was going to get 4 months because it was forgery and identity theft.
Ah.
But my guy who lives in my building knew the judge and totally, he was like, oh, we're going to be good. I got the Goodfellas Boys Will Be Boys sentence. It was amazing. He was like, so as long as you don't do anything stupid, I think we're good. And then he goes to my lawyer and gives him the thumbs up. Good? Good?
Really?
Yeah, I swear to God. I swear to God. And this guy is like a 76-year-old guy in my building. He helped me out. Yeah, he went
Trump,
to the cop.
Trump, this is how Trump, this is
deals. The
well, that's
why
I'm telling you, it's great being a white person in Manhattan. I mean, there's really no problem.
Come on, Michael Flynn, he's a good guy. He made a mistake. Come on.
This is why Trump, it's hard to dislike. I know you got to wrap, but I'm just saying, it's like, this is the way I would run the country.
Uh-huh.
I'm an idiot. This is the way I would do stuff. I'm like, yeah, let's fire that guy. He's a troublemaker.
He's a nut job. Yeah. He's a nut job.
Yeah. How ironic to go to jail for making a license plate when you think about it.
Yeah, right? Oh, I didn't even think about that. I can't believe nobody's ever fought that up before the opposite
great
way.
Great. Fucking great. You'll come back?
I will. I will. Follow me at Joe DeVito Comedy on Twitter. That's like what I got for you.
Oh, thank you
for all kinds of links and stuff.
I want to thank Alex Brazell for setting this show up.
I'd like to thank Alex, too. He's a nice boy.
He's got Alex has excellent taste in comedy.
He does.
He really does. And you and I don't know each other.
I feel like we do now.
We know. I know, but I didn't know who you were.
And Joe's a nice guy.
I know. And Alex said, trust me. Alex said, trust me. And wow. All right. Joe DeVito, DeVito. And what's your website?
JoeDeVito.com.
Funny website, by the way. I love the sparkles on your website.
It's nice,
very
isn't
funny. It? Very funny. Thank you, guys.